Welcome to Weight Loss Awakening, episode number 4. And today I'm in Palm Springs because yesterday I was visiting Dr. Steven Gundry, who wrote the amazing book Plant Paradox, and he was gracious enough to let me follow him. And if you're watching this, I highly recommend that you read that book, The Plant Paradox, because it explains so many amazing things, not just about diet and chronic disease, but also weight loss as well. And honestly, if you were to follow that diet, not only would it be healthy for you, but there's no question that you would lose an enormous amount of weight. It's an incredible diet. It's backed by science. Dr. Gundry is really a great guy, and was super excited to spend the day. The reason I'm still in Palm Springs is because I got a flat tire. Had to spend the night, but Palm Springs is quite nice. The hotel's very nice, and it's just very hot. It's like well over 100 degrees, and it's only around 9 o'clock in the morning. And we're going to go through 7 different features about carbohydrates that make it something that you need to pay attention to. First one is nothing is a pure carbohydrate. For example, spinach. Spinach has carbohydrates, it's got fat, it's got protein. Actually, all vegetables, in fact, have all of these things. Potatoes, they put people on potato diets and they weren't suffering from any sort of macronutrient deficiencies while they were on the diet, meaning that there was protein, there was fat, there were carbohydrates. Those are the 3 macronutrients. And so when it comes to choosing foods or when it comes to thinking about carbohydrates, you have to realize that nothing is a pure carbohydrate unless it's been refined. And if it's been refined, like white sugar, as an example, would be something that would be refined, then it's something in general that you should probably pay attention to and maybe potentially even avoid. We want to understand that whole foods have a mixture of things. Even things that we consider carbohydrates, like potatoes and sweet potatoes, have these additional ingredients in them. So we want to get back to this notion of, well, is it a refined carbohydrate? So white flour, as an example, would be refined. White sugar would be refined. But keep in mind that carbohydrates that we think of as carbohydrates are a mixture of things if they're in their whole plant form. So the key is I want you to focus on getting whole plant foods, whole foods that have a mixture of all these different things. Number 2, fiber counts. So when we're eating an enormous amount of vegetables, we're getting a lot of carbohydrates. But when it comes to the count, we're getting also a lot of fiber. We want this fiber to preferably come from plant sources. And if you're eating a lot of leafy greens, you're getting a lot of these particular types of fibers. So let's move on to number 3. Longevity research matters when it comes to carbohydrates. Right now, there is a resurgence of a diet called the ketogenic diet, which means that people are restricting the amount of carbohydrates in their system to such a low point that they are going into a state called ketosis, where your body starts to burn ketones. A lot of people pursue this because if you look at it metabolically, it appears that ketogenic diets are actually more efficient. In other words, it's like increasing the miles per gallon on a car. The amount of energy that you get out of a certain quantity of food, whether that's since it's fat, you're getting more energy off of that. And so some people think that that's a preferred source. Now, when we're thinking about weight loss, it is true that ketogenic diets do contribute to weight loss. But if we're going for some holy grail of metabolic control, in other words, thinking about it from the context of, yes, it seems to be more efficient, we're excluding a whole host of other factors. One of them being the fact that in nature, in general, there are all kinds of redundant pathways in your body that don't seem efficient, but yet are perfectly normal. We don't necessarily have the full intelligence to be able to understand whether or not just looking at something from an efficiency standpoint is going to be beneficial, because nature is filled with things that seem inefficient. In other words, we don't necessarily have the intelligence to be able to say that by increasing the efficiency of our internal motors, that that's necessarily healthy. And that's why longevity research matters. Research into long-lived populations shows that people are not on ketogenic diets. So we can't exclude the populations around the world that are eating healthy, living a long period of time, and realizing that they have quality sources of carbohydrates that they eat, like in Okinawa, they eat the purple sweet potatoes, as an example. In Japan, they eat white rice. We have to understand that these things that are happening in international cultures that live a long time do matter when it comes to carbohydrates. So let's move on to number four, which is the fact that when you looked at the scientific literature studying diets, low-carb diets worked. Now, you might think what I just said in this are contradictory, and actually, that's not the case. When we look at low-carb diets, they tend to perform better than other types of diets. When we talk about quality carbohydrates, you're not going to be in ketosis. Quality carbohydrates matter. And things like sweet potatoes and a little bit of rice, these are perfectly healthy. You're not going to see increases in inflammatory markers if you're eating proper quantities. We'll get into what those proper quantities are and a really helpful tip on trying to figure out what is perfect for your situation. So number five is leafy greens. And leafy greens matter because leafy greens are a type of carbohydrate. That's what they are. Depending on the vegetable. And generally speaking, they're considered carbohydrates. And I recommend that everyone eat around a pound of leafy greens per day. We'll get into more detail in future lessons about what those vegetables are, how to add them to your diet. But in a nutshell, if you have a smoothie along with your breakfast in the morning, you can add a handful of greens. At lunch, you should be eating a big salad. And you get that, and then at dinner time there should be some steamed greens. It's very easy to get 1 pound of leafy greens in per day. When I mention that to my patients, they often are like, there's no way that I could do that. But quite frankly, you will see amazing benefits in your health as well as your weight if you just focus on getting that pound of greens per day in. And just like I said in other videos, leafy greens, 1 pound a day, one handful of nuts per day. These are the two things that everyone should be getting in their diet. So the next is listing the differences between the different carbohydrates. First, I have to say that when it comes to bread, I have seen no intervention that has caused more weight loss and made more substantial changes in someone's diet than reducing or completely getting rid of bread in their diet. I can't tell you how many times just the reduction of bread has caused people to lose 10 to 20 pounds without changing anything else, just getting rid of bread. And so that has to be said from the outset. Now let's move on to rice. We'll talk about rice in number 7, which is where you're going to learn a little bit about a tool that I use with my patients called the one carb per meal rule. And but rice, generally speaking, white rice is actually better than brown rice. And the reason is because brown rice has what's called lectin. It's a type of protein that is basically in the bran of the rice. And as a result of the bran, it prevents insects from eating it. And if we ingest it, it causes irritation to the gut. And I know a lot of people are thinking, wow, that goes against everything I've thought, that brown rice is better than white rice. That's the general consensus. But if you look at a side-by-side comparison, they're really not all that different when it comes to a nutritional perspective. But that little bit of lectin that you're getting is problematic. And there's a reason why most Asian cultures generally don't eat brown rice. And there's a ancestral wisdom about these sorts of things that we need to pay attention to, even if we don't necessarily understand the science behind them. And now that we're learning about lectins and potentially the causes, the irritation that they can cause and the inflammatory nature that they cause, it's important to be sure to, if you're going to have rice, to stick with white rice. Next is beans. Beans are also a protein, but we're going to lump them into this kind of rough carbohydrate category. Beans are also another lectin-containing food, and you need to be careful with them. They're okay to eat if you pressure cook them. If you pressure cook them, the lectin count drops quite a bit. You know, one of the most amazing things about my time here in Palm Springs yesterday following Dr. Gundry around is to watch the inflammatory markers in the blood drop as people go on lectin-free diets. Now, this is really important for autoimmune diseases like psoriasis and lupus and MS. But when we have these inflammatory markers, there's a general inflammatory state in our body which is not conducive to weight loss. It's not conducive really to overall health. And so they've done studies that have shown that if you have beans and you pressure cook them, the amount of beans, the amount of lectin in the beans decreases dramatically. The next is fruit. Fruit is also is potentially a problem. If you're eating high sugar fruits like pineapple or papaya or mango, you need to be careful of the quantity of these foods. And as Dr. Gundry likes to say, in the animal kingdom, animals eat fruit to bulk up for the winter. So we need to be careful with the amount of fruits that we're eating. There are low sugar fruits like blueberries, blackberries, raspberries, but we'll get into what is the proper amount of fruit in the final step. So we've covered bread, and I'm lumping grains and bread in there all together. The next is rice. We spoke about that. We spoke about fruit. One more thing about fruit is dried fruit. Dried fruit is a condensed form of fruit, and you're going to get a lot of calories in a small portion. So we are going to talk about portion again in number 7. Keep in mind that with dried fruit, you can down full fruits very, very easily. But if you have the whole fruit, you would never eat that many. So like a dried plum, you could eat like 7 of those, but then at the same time, you would never eat 7 plums. So pay attention to the source of the fruit. Like if you were only going to generally eat one plum, then only have one dried plum, if that makes sense to you. And juices, forget about juices. Again, you can choose them according to the rule in number 7 if you wish to do that. But keep in mind that it's all sugar and it's just going to make your blood sugar go up and go down, especially if there's no fiber in that juice. So now we get to the one carb per meal rule. Now this is the thing that I give to my patients who are trying to lose weight, and that is one carb per meal of the following. So one carb per meal of rice, one carb per meal of grain, one carb only per meal of fruit, one carb per meal of fruit juice, one carb per meal of alcohol. What I mean by this is that you can choose from all of those and you only get one. So if you wanted, say, an orange juice, which I am not recommending, but if, let's say, that's what you've chosen, then you can't have bread, you can't have rice, you can't have alcohol if you want to have in that particular meal. You just pick one of those. So if you wanted rice, you'd have one portion of rice, but you wouldn't have any fruit for dessert, or you wouldn't have any juice, you wouldn't have any alcohol. If you wanted some wine, then fine, you have a glass of wine, but then you can't have your potato, you can't have your bread, you can't have your juice or your dessert. Let's say you wanted to splurge and have one piece of dessert. Then you need to knock out the carbohydrate in the first portion of your meal. So instead of having your potato or your sweet potato, and sweet potatoes are preferable to white potatoes for that whole lectin issue that I spoke about before. But if you were choosing to have the dessert, then you need to drop out the potato, or the bread, or whatever might have been accompanied with the meal. And if you do that, and you are eating the 1 pound of greens per day, and your handful of healthy raw nuts per day, and you're watching your refined food products like white flour and sugar and refined oils, you are 80% of the way. When it comes to counting carbohydrates, there's a link I'm also going to provide here to a video that I made as well on learning how to count carbohydrates to keep yourself in that range. And it's a very, very easy skill, super, super easy to understand how to count. But if you stick to the one carb per meal rule, then you are totally set. So these are the 7 items that I like to discuss with my patients when it comes to carbohydrates. I hope that this video has been really helpful, that it sort of clears up some of the misconceptions about carbohydrates, because that's one of the things that trips people up all the time. So thank you for coming to my channel. I appreciate your visit and you're watching to the very end. And if you haven't subscribed, if you're watching this on YouTube, hit the subscription button, give us a thumbs up. If you are watching this on YouTube, the link to our private Facebook group where we have a supportive community of people is going to be in the link below. Please leave your comments so that I can refine these messages and make sure that they are clear, that I'm not being confusing, you know, be critical so that I can learn to be a better presenter and to provide this service and this information to you. That's very important to me. So please leave a comment below. Till next time, this is Dr. Carb for Weight Loss Awakening. See you next time.